Okay, so friends, we are going to cover five important topics under current affairs, and these topics are from defense and security perspective. Like I have included these topics, in detail, but the thing is we are going to discuss in prelims exam perspective. Okay, so the topic that we are going to cover today are: number one, Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons, in short it is known as OPCW. Second is Integrated Air Defense Weapon System, IADWS. Third topic we are going to cover is Financial Action Task Force, in short it is known as FATF. Then we will cover militarization of the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Okay. And fifth topic is space warfare. So we are going to cover these five topics, and the theme for today's discussion is defense and security. Okay. So under the theme defense, okay, and security, we are going to cover these five topics. And apart from this, we are going to see one government act, which is the Transgender Persons Protection of Rights Act 2019. So these are the topics that we are going to cover today. So I would request every one of you to mute yourself, right? If you are not muted, so that like no one else gets any kind of disturbance. Okay. So anyone getting any disturbance, you can just type on the screen, so that like if that person is not muted, so I can mute that person. Okay. So let us start the first topic. The first topic is Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons. This is an important topic for prelims exam. Okay, so why it was in news? Because the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons, for the first time explicitly blamed Syria for toxic attack. Okay, so this organization has for the first time taken the name of a particular country. Okay, that like it was responsible for toxic attacks. Earlier, this particular organization did not have the mandate to name a particular country. It could only, tell that, some toxic attack has happened in this particular place. But like it was earlier never into the business of blaming any country or any organization. It was just, in the business of telling that a chemical attack has happened here or there. Okay. And this particular organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons, it is an organization that is entrusted with the mandate of, destruction of all the chemical weapons facilities, around the world. Okay. And especially in the member countries of the OPCW. Okay. So this is the thing. Let us talk more about this particular news. So OPCW's investigation and identification team in its report said that Syrian Arab Air Force used NERV gas sarin. Okay. So it used NERV gas sarin and chlorine three times in Itamenab, Syria in 2017. Okay. So in this respect, we are going to discuss in detail what do we mean by NERV gas, okay, sarin and chlorine. Okay. So these are two important, gases that can be used as a chemical weapon. Okay. So we are going to see the property of sarin gas as a NERV agent when it was developed for the first time. Sarin gas was developed for the first time by Germany, and they developed this particular gas as a pesticide. Okay, this gas is odorless, means like it does not have any smell. It is colorless. Okay, it looks like water, but the thing is this gas has some kind of property that once you inhale this gas, you will not be able to respire. Means like oxygen intake in your body will be stopped completely, and you will die within minutes. Okay, so the thing is this NERV gas sarin is a very, very deadly gas. Okay, so this is the thing. Now we are going to see about OPCW. Okay, so it is the implementing body for the Chemical Weapons Convention. OPCW means Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons. It is the implementing body for the Chemical Weapons Convention. Okay, there is a convention, its name is a Chemical Weapons Convention. I'll talk the full name of this particular convention, and this is headquartered. OPCW is headquartered in Hague, okay, Netherlands, and the full name of the convention is Convention on the Prohibition of the Development, Production, Stockpiling, and Use of Chemical Weapons, and on their Destruction. Okay, the Chemical Weapons Convention entered into force on 29th April 1997. Okay, so this particular convention is this is the full name of this convention: Convention on the Prohibition of the Development, Production, and Stockpiling and the Use of Chemical Weapons. Okay, in short, it is known as Chemical Weapons Convention. Then you know the CWC, Chemical Weapons Convention, aims to eliminate the entire category of weapons of mass destruction by prohibiting the development, production, acquisition, stockpiling, retention, transfer, or use of chemical weapons by state parties. And to achieve this goal of preventing, chemistry from ever gaining, from ever again being used for warfare, CWC, okay, Chemical Weapons Convention, has four provisions. Okay, what are those four provisions of the Chemical Weapons Convention? One of the provision is destroying all existing chemical weapons under international verification by the Organization for Prohibition of Chemical Weapons, OPCW. Second provision is monitoring chemical industry to prevent chemical weapons from re-emerging. Okay. Third provision under this Chemical Weapons Convention is providing assistance and protection to state parties against chemical threats. Then fostering international cooperation to strengthen implementation of the convention and promote the peaceful use of chemistry. Okay, so these are the four provisions under the Chemical Weapons Convention. It is important that you should be, remembering, or you should be learning these points. Then CWC, Chemical Weapons Convention, was signed and ratified by 193 countries. And India is also a party to the, Chemical Weapons Convention. Okay. So Israel has signed but not ratified the convention yet, and non-signatory states to the Chemical Weapons Convention are Egypt, North Korea, and South Sudan. Okay, these are the three countries that are non-signatory to the Chemical Weapons Convention. Okay, apart from this, they have given some detail like 90% of the global population are under the protection of the convention, and 97% of the chemical weapons stockpiles declared by the possessory states have been verifiably destroyed. It simply means that like 98% of the global population are safe from the use of any kind of chemical weapons, because this Chemical Weapons Convention has 193 member countries. Okay, so almost similar number of membership as the United Nations organization. Okay, and this organization for the prohibition of chemical weapons, which is OPCW, was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 2013. It is also an important fact that OPCW was awarded Nobel Peace Prize in 2013 for its extensive efforts to eliminate chemical weapons. So now in this respect, we are going to learn in detail about the sarin gas and chlorine gas. Okay, how these gas can be used as chemical weapons. Okay, so sarin is a clear, colorless, and tasteless liquid that has no odor. Okay. So it is a clear liquid, colorless, tasteless, and no odor. Means like no smell, no color, okay? Looks transparent. So this is the thing. It looks like water, okay? It looks like water, but it is a deadly weapon. Deadly, weapon of mass destruction. However, sarin can evaporate into a vapor and spread into the environment, okay? Sarin can evaporate into a vapor and spread into the environment. It is a human-made chemical warfare agent. Okay, so the thing is, it does not exist naturally. It is a human-made chemical warfare agent classified as NURB agent. Okay, sarin was originally developed in 1938 in Germany as a pesticide. It is also known as GB. Okay, this particular thing, sarin gas, is also known as GB. It was first developed in 1938 in Germany as a pesticide. Now, if we talk about chlorine gas, okay, it appears to be yellow color, yellow green in color. It does sink and displace breathable air, so it can asphyxiate people. It simply means like it appears yellow green in color. Okay, so chlorine gas is yellow green in color. It does sink and displace breathable air. Means like it sinks down and it displaces breathable air. So like it can cause respiratory problem. You will not be able to inhale or exhale. You will not be able to respire if chlorine gas is there. Okay. around you. So this is how nerve gas works. So this thing you can read yourself, right? How the nerve gas works. So this is all about this particular article. So here we need to understand that Organization for the Prohibition of the Chemical Weapons is an organization that is an implementing body to the Chemical Weapons Convention. Okay. It is an implementing body to the Chemical Weapons Convention. It has 193 member countries. Okay. And recently, for the first time, it has blamed a particular country. Earlier, it was not into the business of blaming different countries. It was just, into the business that some chemical attack has happened in this place and that place. So it was never involved into any kind of, political statement and all. Recently, it made a statement related to that. And in this respect, it is important for everyone to understand the four provisions of this Chemical Weapons Convention. And then we have understood, what are those countries that are non-signatory countries. Okay, non-signatory countries are Egypt, North Korea, and South Sudan. These are non-signatory countries. And then Israel has signed but not ratified the convention. India has signed as well as ratified the convention. This Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons, has received Nobel Peace Prize in the year 2013. And in this respect, we have learned about sarin gas and chlorine gas. Okay. So this is all about on this topic. Now let us talk about the next topic for the day. Okay. Next topic is integrated air defense weapon system. Okay. We are going to discuss about integrated air defense weapon system. So why this particular topic was in news? Because the United States has approved the sale of an integrated air defense weapon system to India. Okay. So the thing is, this integrated air defense weapon system is coming from the United States to India. Okay. So it is coming from United States to India. This is the thing. Okay. So where it is manufactured? In the United States. Which country is acquiring? Okay. India is acquiring. This is an important information. Now let us understand what do we mean by integrated air defense weapon system. Okay. We are going to understand about integrated air defense weapon system. So the integrated air defense weapon system is called as the National Advanced Surface to Air Missile System. Okay. So this integrated air defense weapon system has another name. Its name is National Advanced Surface to Air Missile System. In short, NASAMS. Okay. National Advanced Surface to Air Missile System. Second. Okay. Then it is an upgraded version of NASAMS. Okay. Developed by the US firm Raytheon. Okay, so this particular weapon system was developed by a US firm. Its name is Raytheon. And it will be a combination of different weapons like, Stinger missiles, gun systems, and the advanced medium range air to air missile. It is also known as AMRAAM. Okay, AMRAAM. So the thing is, advanced medium range air to air missile. Advanced medium range air to air missile. AMRAAMs. Okay. Backed by 3D Sentinel radars, fire distribution centers, and command and control units. Okay, so it has these things. And apart from this, let us talk about the significance of the deal. What is the significance of this deal? Deal means the United States has approved the sale of integrated air defense weapon system to India. So it involves a financial deal. So what is the significance? Okay, first significance is it will help India to modernize its armed forces. Second significance is multi-layered missile shield over the national capital territory of Delhi. Means like it will provide multi-layer missile shield over the NCT of Delhi. Okay. Third significance of this deal is it will strengthen the US-Indian strategic relationship. Then next importance of this deal is like it will, create a regional balance, because as we know that China is, is strengthening its muscle power in the South Asia and Southeast Asia. So it is important for India to balance the regional geopolitics. So it will help India to balance the regional geopolitics. Okay. So this is the significance of this deal. So now we are going to understand about the proposed multi-layered missile shield for NCT of Delhi. Okay. Because Delhi is the capital of India. Here, all VIP people, right? All the politicians, all other things, big establishments in India are located over here. So like Delhi being the capital of India, it needs more protection. So this particular, you know, advanced air defense, you know, missile system or like advanced air defense weapon system that India is acquiring from US is going to, you know, help India to boost its, you know, boost its capability against any kind of missile attack on Indian territory. Okay. So what are the things? So we are going to understand about multi-layered missile shield over the national capital territory of Delhi. Okay. So these things are numbered over here. You can see on the screen, like number one, outermost BMD layer, number two, S-400 layer, number three, Akash layer, number four, NASAMS layer, okay, number five, Bharat 8 layers. So we are going to discuss these layers one by one in detail, okay. So now outermost BMD, BMD means ballistic missile destroyer layer, okay, outermost ballistic layer, ballistic missile destroyer layer. So here what will happen? So on the atmosphere above the national capital territory of Delhi, there will be, you know, like outermost ballistic missile defense layer, where like on this, on that particular range, if any ballistic missile attack happens, so this particular system will be able to, you know, tackle those things. So what is there written? Let us see. Two-tier indigenous system of AAD, advanced air defense, and PAD, Prithvi air defense interceptor missiles are there in the outermost, you know, outermost BMD layer. Then designed to track and destroy ballistic missiles both inside and outside at latitude, at altitudes 15 to 25 kilometer and 100 to 80 kilometers. So like this is the, you know, this is like inside this particular range, and this is outside that range. So like in this range, any missile attack that happens, you know, the outermost BMD layer will be able to, you know, tackle those things. Okay. So how they are doing it? They are doing it in two phases. Phase one, interceptor missile with 4.5 Mach speed. Mach means, you know, it is this sound, like a speed of sound, 4.5 times the speed of sound. Okay. Meant for 2000 kilometer range, range enemy missiles. Okay. System is almost ready in this case. If we talk about phase two, interceptor missiles with 6 to 7 Mach speed will be for 5,000 kilometer class missiles. Okay. So in phase one, they are, you know, developing, you know, those missiles that will have a range of 2,000 kilometer. And in phase two, they will develop missiles that will have a range of 5,000 kilometer. Okay. So in phase one, they're going to develop missiles, you know, that will have a speed of 4.5 Mach. In phase two, 6 to 7 Mach speed will be achieved. And then second, you know, second protective layer that is available, you know, like over the national capital territory of Delhi is S-400 layer, okay? So the thing is, like, it simply means it is not a layer of the atmosphere. It is the layer which is being protected by S-400 missile system, okay? Missile defense system. Are you understanding? S-400 layer means it is the layer of the atmosphere above the national capital territory of Delhi where, you know, protection against missile attack will be done by S-400 missile defense system. Okay. So here we are using Russian Triumph surface to air missile systems. Okay. And apart from this, missiles with interception range of 120, 200, 250 and 380 kilometers will be used. Okay. So the thing is, missiles with interception range means like these missiles will have a range, like within this range, they will be able to intercept any missile attack. Okay. So this is the thing, 120 kilometer, 200 kilometer, 250 kilometer and 380 kilometer. And these are the, you know, price information. It is not important for us. Okay. Deliveries of 5 squadrons from October 2018 to April 2023. So within this time period, India is going to receive 5 squadrons of S-400 missile from Russia. Okay. This is the information that we need to understand. Okay. So I hope it was understood. Now we will understand about Akash layer. Okay. Akash layer is not a layer of the atmosphere again. It is the layer which is going to be protected. It is the layer of the atmosphere which is going to be protected by the Akash air defense missile system. Okay. So this is the thing. So Akash layer. So it is indigenous area defense missile system. Okay. It has a range of 25 kilometers. Indian Air Force is inducting 15 squadrons of Akash-1 and two systems for rupees like this. Rupee information is not important. Okay. Army has inducted two regiments for this particular thing. It is also not important. So we are just understanding, like, you know, what are the multi-layered missile defense system is available for the National Capital Territory of Delhi. Okay. And then this particular layer, which is in news. Okay. So like this entire article we are seeing with reference to this particular topic. So here, NASAMS layer, okay, NASAMS layer. NASAMS, what do we mean by this thing? So I have already discussed, so I'll take you back to that particular thing. Here, now you see, okay, NASAMS means National Advanced Surface to Air Missile System, okay. National Advanced, so here you just need to see, you know, the thing that I'm, you know, like underlining, National Advanced Surface to Air Missile System. Okay, so now we are going to discuss about that thing, National Advanced Surface to Air Missile System layer. Okay, so like under this layer there will be quick reaction, okay, network system of Stingers gun system and AM RAM missiles. Okay, advanced medium range, okay, like this air, like, you know, missile system like that. Then deal for, so this deal is not important. Okay. And apart from this, we will also talk about Barak 8 layers. Okay, so we will have Barak 8 layers. So medium to long range surface to air missile, SAM means surface to air missile systems, jointly developed by Israeli Aerospace Industries and the DRDO. DRDO means Defense Research and Development Organization. Then interception range of 70 to 100 kilometer. Systems being delivered to Navy. Okay, so these are other information. So now if you talk about what are the, you know, protection available over the airspace of National Capital Territory of Delhi, we do have outermost BMD layer. BMD stands for Ballistic Missile Defense Layer. Then we do have S-400 layer, means like this is the layer of the atmosphere where, you know, protection against missile attack will be done by the S-400, you know, missile defense system. We are going to, we are actually, you know, like procuring these S-400 missiles from Russia. Then Akash layer, okay, this is the layer of the atmosphere where, you know, like missile defense system will be provided by the Akash missiles, and it is, you know, indigenous area defense missile systems. So it is developed indigenously by India, Akash system. Then NASAMS we have talked about, okay. Then we have talked about Barak 8 layer. So it is, you know, it is being developed, okay. It is jointly developed by Israeli Aerospace Industries and DRDO. So in this article, what we have learned in detail is like we have learned about integrated air defense weapon system. Okay. So the thing is, why it was in news? Because the government of the United States of America has approved the sale of integrated air defense weapon system to India. Okay. So it was a deal between the government of USA and government of India. So this particular thing, integrated air defense weapon system, is called in India as National Advanced Surface to Air Missile System, second part. Okay, first part was there already. Okay, so the thing is, which this second part is an upgraded version of National Advanced Surface to Air Missile System. So in this respect, we have talked about what are the significances of this deal. Okay, so I hope it is understood. Now let us move to the next topic for the day. We are going to discuss about Financial Action Task Force. Okay, we are going to discuss about Financial Action Task Force. Why this particular thing was news? Because, you know, Pakistan is likely to remain in the gray list of the Financial Action Task Force for failing to comply with the deadlines to prosecute and penalize terrorist financing in the country. So this is the, you know, reference with which this particular topic, like Financial Action Task Force, was in news. Now we will understand about Financial Action Task Force, right? So what is Financial Action Task Force? It is a global money laundering and terrorist financing watchdog. Okay, it is a global money laundering and terrorist financing watchdog, and it is an intergovernmental body. What do we mean by this? Like, the governments are party to this particular Financial Action Task Force. Means private players are not, you know, members of the Financial Action Task Force. Only sovereign governments are part of this Financial Action Task Force. So that's why it is an intergovernmental body. And if you talk about its membership, it comprises of 37 member countries, including India. It means like India is also a member of the Financial Action Task Force. And it has two regional organizations. one of the regional organization is European Commission, and second is Gulf Cooperation Council. Okay, second is Gulf Cooperation Council. So it has 37 member countries, including India, and two regional organizations. One of the regional organization is the European Commission, and second is the Gulf Cooperation Council. When it was established, in July 1989 by a group of seven summit. Okay, so group of seven members, G7, you know, summit was held in Paris. So then, you know, this particular organization was established. Okay, and apart from this, what does this particular body does? This particular body releases a series of special recommendations, okay, to combat terrorism, and which outlines measures to deprive terrorists and terrorist organizations of access to funding and financial systems. Okay, now if you talk about what is the role of Financial Action Task Force in combating terrorist financing, it sets global standards to combat terrorist financing. Okay, so how it does? Okay, so the thing is, FATF ensures all its members have implemented measures to cut off terrorism related financial flows in accordance with the FATF recommendations. All member countries are required to criminalize and the financing of individual terrorist and terrorist organizations, then freeze terrorist assets without delay and implementing ongoing prohibitions. Then it will also help in evaluating countries' ability to prevent, detect, investigate, and prosecute the financing of terrorism. Okay, so the FATF, you know, issues two lists. What are those lists that are issued by the FATF? One of the lists that is issued by FATF is known as black list. Second one is known as gray list. Okay, but black list is not, black list and gray list are not the official names of these lists. Official names are, for blacklist, it is high risk jurisdiction subject to call for action. Okay, so if we talk about blacklist, it is officially known as high risk jurisdictions subjected to call for action. Okay, so you can read more about this particular thing. What do we mean by blacklist? Okay, so, and then current FATF blacklist includes two countries. Under blacklist, there are two countries. One of the countries, North Korea, second country is Iran. Okay, this is an important information for prelims. Then gray list, if you talk about gray list, officially it is known as jurisdiction under increased monitoring. Okay, so Pakistan is also in the gray list now. Okay, so the thing is, once a particular country is put into gray list, the Financial Action Task Force will ask that particular country to take some measures so that that country can, you know, reduce the terror financing in its borders, or terror financing to some of the organizations that may be, you know, working from their territory. And at the same time, the countries that are put under the gray list, they may face some kind of, you know, restrictions or some kind of sanctions from international institutions like International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, and like that. Okay, and apart from this, what are the other mandates of the Financial Action Task Force? It assists jurisdiction in implementing financial provision of the United Nations Security Council resolutions on terrorism. Okay, these are the things. Then if you want to learn about terror financing, how the terror financing happens and all, okay, so these things are included in this particular table itself. Okay, so once I share the document, you can read directly from this particular document. I hope it was understood. Okay, so what are the points that we need to learn from this topic? That Financial Action Task Force is a global money laundering and terror financing watchdog. It is an intergovernmental body. It means like only sovereign governments or sovereign, you know, countries are party to this Financial Action Task Force. Then it has 37 member countries, including India. It has two regional organizations. One of the regional organization is European Commission. Second is Gulf Cooperation Council. It was established in July 1989 by group of seven summit or G7 summit in Paris. It releases special recommendations, series of special recommendations. Then role of FATF in combating terror financing, its role is multi-pronged. Okay, one thing is, it sets global standards to combat terrorist financing. Second is, it evaluates countries' ability to prevent, detect, investigate, and prosecute the financing of terrorism. Third thing is, it assists the jurisdictions in implementing financial provision of the United Nations Security Council resolutions on terrorism. Okay, and it has two lists. Okay, it issues two lists. One of the list is commonly known as blacklist. Officially, it is known as high risk jurisdiction subjected to a call for action. Second list is known as gray list, which is officially known as jurisdictions under increased monitoring. Okay, so these are the list, and so some additional information is included related to peril financing. You can read it right in your free time once I share the document. Now we will talk about the fourth topic for the day, which is militarization of Andaman and Nicobar Island. Okay, we are going to discuss about fourth topic for the day, which is militarization of Andaman and Nicobar Island. So why it was in news? Because the Ladakh standoff with China has catalyzed India's effort to strengthen its military presence at the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Okay, recently there was a standoff between the, you know, armed forces of India and armed forces of China. And so, like, because of that particular thing, it has, you know, it has set the tone in India that we should, you know, guard our southern border also, like southern maritime border. So especially Andaman and Nicobar Island becomes important. So it becomes important for us to militarize our southern portion, okay, southern portion. So in this respect, we will, you know, we will learn about, you know, Andaman and Nicobar Island, okay. So before I discuss anything else in this article, so I'll take you to, you know, the map of the Andaman and Nicobar Island. Okay. So we will understand this particular map first. Okay. Just a minute. I'm making this map little smaller. Okay. So that, like, you can have a bigger picture of this map. So this is the map of Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Okay. Now, so on the top of it, there is a channel, it is known as Pre-Paris Channel, okay. Then there are Coco Islands, which belongs to Myanmar. We do have a Coco Channel, okay, Coco Channel. So Coco Channel actually, you know, it separates the Coco Islands of Myanmar and the North Andaman Island, okay. And or like we can talk about, it separates the Coco Islands of Myanmar and the Andaman and Nicobar group of islands, okay. So here, like, this is, you know, the Andaman Island over here. Andaman Island is divided into four parts. Okay, one of the part is known as North Andaman. Okay, second part is known as Middle Andaman. Third part is known as South Andaman. Fourth part is known as Little Andaman. Okay, so Andaman group of islands can be broadly categorized into four parts. One of the part is known as North Andaman. Okay, second is Middle Andaman. Third is South Andaman. Fourth is Little Andaman. So we have discussed about Coco Channel. Coco Channel separates, okay. Channel means it is a narrow passage of water that separates two, you know, land masses. So it is separating Coco Island and Andaman group of island, right? Then we do have another passage which is known as Duncan Passage over here. This Duncan Passage, it is a narrow passage of water, okay, which is around 27 nautical miles. 1 nautical mile is much more than 1 kilometer length, okay. So this Duncan Passage separates the South Andaman Island with Little Andaman Island, okay. And below this, we do have 10 degree channel, okay. That 10 degree channel actually separates the Andaman group of island with the Nicobar group of island. And this 10 degree channel lies between the Little Andaman and the Kar Nicobar, okay. So we are going to discuss about the details of the, you know, Nicobar group of island also, okay. So let us move little down over here. Let us have a look into the Nicobar group of island. So Nicobar group of island is also divided into, you know, different parts. One of the part is known as Kar Nicobar, okay, Kar Nicobar. Then we do have, you know, Little Nicobar. You can see over here, Little Nicobar. Then we have, you know, third, Great Nicobar, okay. So it is divided, you know, logically into three portions. Kar Nicobar, okay, Kar Nicobar. Then we have Little Nicobar. Then we have Great Nicobar, okay. These are the you know, groups where it can be divided, okay. So, you know, like, this is the Nicobar group of island. Then there is a channel over here which is known as Sombero channel, okay, Sombero channel. And this channel is between this particular thing, like, you know, Little Nicobar and Kar Nicobar, we can talk about, okay. So this is Nicobar group of island. So this channel is between Little Nicobar and Kar Nicobar, okay. And apart from this, we do have, you know, like, we do have some other channel. So the thing is, there is another channel which is known as Great Channel, which is also known as 6 degrees channel, that actually separates, you know, Indian group of Andaman and Nicobar Island with, you know, some islands of Indonesia. Okay, so this is known as Banda Aceh. Okay, Banda Aceh, it is part of Indonesia. So 6 degree channel actually is the limit for India. Okay, so apart from this, we are going to see some of the special, you know, military locations in this particular Andaman and Nicobar group of island. Okay, these are Diglipur Bay over here. Then we have Port Blair Harbor. Okay, friends, the discussion may get terminated within a minute. If it gets terminated, you can join me again by clicking on the same link. Okay, so the thing is, we are going to meet again after 15 minutes. Okay, so maybe at 7 we will meet again and we will have half an hour discussion to finish the topic. Okay, so after 15 minutes we are going to meet again once the discussion gets terminated from my automatically. Okay, there is a limitation on 40 minutes on this, and I'm recording this